Well, boys, looks like you started the fun without me.
You're all sick. Every last one of you.
We're going to need a bigger gun.
What's the matter? You're scared of things that go boom, boom, boom.
Give me one goddamn reason why I shouldn't blow your goddamn brains all over that goddamn wall.
My name is Eric. I am here today with good movie filmmaker enthusiast Michael Kester, and we are going to do two awesome films by awesome directors. Yeah. What are the movies we're doing on the goddamn show today?
We're going to do Reservoir Dogs and Desperado.
You're goddamn right we're going to do Reservoir Dogs and Desperado, and if you don't like it, you can fucking shut off your Zoom is what you can do. So we're well into year three now.
We're not well into it. This is the first episode of year three.
Well, one down, 50-something to
We're not even down yet.
All right. Well,
the intro literally started probably 17 seconds ago.
I'm working on it. Oh, we have some things to say about Mr. Rodriguez and Mr. Tarantino, probably in the opposite order. If you don't want to hear those things, and you just want to skip right to the part where we talk about the movies, we have chapters. So you can just skip into that. But before you do, we are going to spoil the movies. We're going to talk about the endings of the movies. We're going to talk about the plot points of the movies. We're going to talk about the trailers, sort of the movies. So if you haven't seen Reservoir Dogs, go see that first. And in the meantime, just skip on over to Desperado. And if you haven't seen that, skip to the end of the show, and we'll see what the hell we're doing next time.
Right on.
This is old school Tarantino and Rodriguez. We're talking about the old. This is not the oldest Rodriguez.
No.
Only because I think it's only necessary to tackle one of the Mexico trilogy.
Right.
And if you're going to tackle one,
it's got
to
be Desperado.
Desperado is just the one you do. But when Tarantino was at the festivals showing Reservoir Dogs, that's actually when the two of them met and were great films like From Dusk Till Dawn and Grindhouse originally began.
Right.
You know what else? We're probably going to spoil the end of Reservoir Dogs in Desperado.
Potentially.
We'll talk about that a little bit. I think these two guys are masters of icons, and if there is a theme to today's show, which there isn't, but if there was, that's probably what it would be.
Yeah.
The most icon-ridden films that I think we've done in a long time. And I'd also want to make sure we get to how Rodriguez fills his movies with icons, because he has a strategy to do that that I think is pretty cool. Also, everything I know about filmmaking, I learned from Robert Rodriguez. So that's going to be a very packed portion of the show. But why don't we get to the Quentin Tarantino movie first?
All right, so yeah, we'll get into Tarantino first. Let's talk about Reservoir Dogs. But before we actually talk about the film, let's talk about why we're going to put Quentin Tarantino in front of Robert Rodriguez.
There's a lot of preempting going on here.
Well, unfortunately, a while ago, actually quite fortunately, a while ago, a film came out called Grindhouse. But unfortunately for Grindhouse, they put Planet Terror, which was Rodriguez's portion of the film,
first,
before Death Proof,
yeah,
which was Tarantino's portion of the film.
It's true.
And poor Death Proof was just overshadowed to no end by Planet Terror.
Yeah.
And it may never, ever regain the footing it may have had if it were released beforehand.
Sure.
So we're going to sack that experiment. We're going to put Tarantino first, knowing that Desperado is the ride that it is.
Yeah.
And we'll start with the Tarantino, which, not to say it's bad, but it's dense in a very different way.
Yeah, sure.
It's dense in a shut the fuck up. Everybody's going to be talking for an hour and a half.
Yes, yelling.
And in Desperado, it's shut the fuck up because there's too many bullets. I
shooting,
can't hear
right.
you.
Yeah. Yeah, if we're going to start at the origins of Quentin Tarantino, and man, are these the fucking origins of Quentin Tarantino, I think we need to just talk about his signature, because that is all over Reservoir Dogs. And you'll see it more in Pulp Fiction.
Sure.
And after Pulp Fiction, I think he goes some different directions.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's been a while since I've seen Reservoir Dogs, and having seen all of his stuff after that over and over and over again,
right,
and coming back to Reservoir Dogs, I noticed stuff from, you know, some of these signature shots that he always does. I mean, I think his camera work, to me, this probably isn't true. I'm going to say this, and it's not true at all. But I think his camera work is the thing that makes you spot Tarantino the fastest.
Yeah.
Other people will tell you it's what, vulgarity, violence,
for me, it's
pop culture stuff.
For me, it's when people are talking, it's you want to listen.
Yeah.
It's Tarantino films are some of the only films where conversations actually quiet me down.
Yeah, right.
A lot of times films will have conversation and I'm along for the ride because the film is doing its own thing, but honestly, I don't feel like the dialogue is natural. I don't feel like it's interesting. I don't feel like the characters are really exposing any of themselves by the dialogue. all of which are the complete opposite when any Tarantino character is saying anything.
Well, and some of his shots really lend themselves to that. You know, the first thing we ever get in the movie, it's almost poetic. It's Tarantino talking in his first film, giving what is such a Tarantino-esque piece of dialogue about Madonna's Like a Virgin. And you have the camera circling around the table. You know, it's the scene, the Like a Virgin scene, but also the one people remember as the tipping scene.
Right.
So before they talk about that, they have the pop culture thing. You know, the first fucking thing you see with Tarantino is the Madonna pop culture thing. But in that scene, you're also getting to know these characters. You're hanging out with them. I think probably the worst insult, if you were in a conversation with Quentin Tarantino and you wanted to injure him like no other, the one thing you would need to tell the man is that you don't like hanging out with his characters.
Yeah.
I think that above everything else he ever tries to do, probably even above creating enjoyable films, he likes to have characters that are that you want to hang out with. That was the entire premise, really, of Jackie Brown. That's, you know, the one thing I hear him defend Jackie Brown with all the time, which is one of his films that critics really blasted.
Mm-hmm.
Tarantino's a guy that is pretty well received by critics on almost all of his stuff. But Jackie Brown's, you know, what he says is a hangout film. In the beginning of Reservoir Dogs, you're hanging out with these characters. Even when he's doing something exploitative, look at Death Proof. Death Proof, maybe even to a fault, is all characters. It's something that's a callback to roadsploitation. It's kind of, in your mind, those movies are all about cars. But what are you doing in Death Proof? You're hanging out. You're hanging out in a living room. You're hanging out in a diner. You see the same circle scene in the diner for what seems like 25 minutes, listening to everybody talk about cars. And while the characters aren't any deeper than those you might find in a typical roadsploitation movie, you know way more about them than you even want to.
Yeah, I feel like the characters in Death Proof don't really have any definition, save for one or two.
Mm-hmm.
I think that that's a big flaw.
They're not deep. They're not deep.
Well, it's not only that. It's that you spend so much time with characters that don't, they're static. Nothing happens. They're kind of boring.
Sure.
That's not the case in Reservoir Dogs.
No, not at all.
It can be chalked up to the actors. We have a very Tarantino cast.
Yeah.
But we also have a really great cast of actors that are filling all these roles and lending themselves in very different ways. I think of Steve Buscemi, who's Mr. Pink, and Michael Madsen, who's Mr. Blonde, are probably the two most polar opposite characters.
Yeah.
Mr. Blonde is loose and cool and he does not play by the books. He plays by his own rules and he doesn't have a boss. And Mr. Pink, he gets away in the end because he follows the rules. He knows exactly what needs to be done. He does it and he's careful.
He says it over and over. I'm a professional.
Yeah.
With the exception of Mr. Blue, who is almost comically not an important actor, who has very few scenes in the film, and Mr. Brown as well, who's played by Tarantino, who is only well known as far as his screen time in there because it's the director, because it's Quentin Tarantino. He gets about as much screen time as Mr. Blue, maybe a little more. Everybody, I mean, we'll reserve ourselves from just listing off the cast. People can go on IMDb, but huge players. Everybody is a huge player in this movie. And the movie itself is driven by the characters. The story is told through getting background on the characters. You know, they have this classic setup, one that I've told you before I love. Who is the mole? Who is the rat? I don't know why it's always weird road references, but it's the same thing,
who
right?
Who is the squirrel?
Where is the leak, you know? And so in trying to piece together two things, what happened at this central event that they never show you, this heist, and also who is the rat, you want to find out more about the characters' backgrounds. And so you start eliminating them as possible subjects one by one by learning about the characters.
Right.
What are their motivations and who stands to profit, to make it sound like a conspiracy? And so you get the title cards, also something very Tarantino-esque, something he does in almost all of his movies.
Pretty sure it's all the films.
Yeah, I don't want to say that for sure, but let's say a vast majority of the films. And each title card here is telling you the backstory of a different character. And the way it tells the backstory and the flashbacks from the heist is sort of nonlinear storytelling. I think I look at flashbacks as a different mechanism than nonlinear. You know, Pulp Fiction defines nonlinear storytelling. Mm-hmm. When you think about popular films with nonlinear story, that's the go-to.
Yeah.
It's the film that inspired so many other films, you know, after it to do that. But Reservoir Dogs did some of that stuff first. And it did it in flashbacks, and that helps you piece together what happened at this event. I think it's very clever and something that's done again with the briefcase in Pulp Fiction. The whole event that happens, the whole heist, they don't show you the heist. They tell you the heist. Mm-hmm. They describe to you what happens. But it's basically an extreme version of that don't show the monster thing mm-hmm. we always talk about. How in horror movies, when something stays hidden in the darkness, your mind makes it way more fucked up than yeah. anything they could show you and more personally appealing to you.
Right.
So this heist, you're supposed to believe that Mr. Blonde, for instance, right. went absolutely insane here and shot up everybody and went crazy.
That specifically is probably one of the most horrific things imaginable, but if you saw it, it would take so much edge away.
Sure, absolutely.
I think seeing Mr. White pretend to hold a gun and just saying bang,
yes.
bang, bang, that is, he says bang and I jump.
Yeah.
Just because I'm thinking, wow, he shot another one.
Yeah.
And he shot another one.
Yeah.
And I'm sure that, you know, seeing Michael Madsen there shooting squibs off of people's heads,
yeah.
that wouldn't faze me because I'm jaded.
Yeah, yeah, right. But in your head, it plays out. See, this is great because you have seen, you know, billions of these horror movies where people are mutilated. So if I were to ask you to go away and write this scene or film this scene, and then somebody who's only seen 6 movies in their whole life to film that scene, assuming that you're both great filmmakers and can do that, you would bring back completely different scenes. You right. play them out completely differently in your mind. But to both of you, it's the most horrific right. scene that you could possibly think of. So they're clever in not showing you that. And that also helps because you don't know if you can believe these characters. Mm-hmm. You're trying to figure out the entire movie until the reveal, you know, who do you believe? And so Mr. White says that Mr. Blonde was just killing people one after another, and Mr. Blonde admits to that. But as Mr. Pink says, he seems pretty collected right now. He seems uh-huh. pretty together, almost too much together. You know, he is just way too cool for the situation that's going on right now. He should be a little more panicked. So we're wondering what the character is capable of. And that brings us up to the scene, which I think is one of the most memorable Tarantino scenes, probably the most memorable
I would
from
say
the
so.
Film. You know exactly the scene I'm
yeah,
talking about.
Right. It's the scene where we're stuck in the middle, comes on the radio.
K. Billy's Super Sounds of the 70s. Right. Something that's haunting the characters.
Right.
They talk about it in the intro. It's playing everywhere in the world. It just holds the world together.
And Mr. Blonde kind of dances over to the captive police officer
mm-hmm.
and cuts him up a little bit. And then ultimately removes his ear, which again is done in a don't show the monster fashion.
Yep.
However, I would argue that I think now, maybe then it was a different story, but now I think a graphic ear slicing could probably be done very beautifully.
Something that made Tarantino really love Eli Roth back in the Hostel days.
Right.
You know, seeing that kind of gore. I mean, not to say that he didn't show that because he couldn't create it.
Right.
But the image that he had in his mind was probably something
sure.
akin to what Eli Roth does. I think it's a really clever scene in that the camera pans away from the worst part, almost as if the movie cannot even mm-hmm. watch itself. It is so disgusted and horrified, even the camera cringes and turns to the side. Building on, you know, just a more specific version of the thing we've been talking about.
Right.
And just when you think that scene cannot get any harsher, any more, they bring in the gasoline.
Right.
You know, he's dousing this guy. You know what's going to come. All the while still maintaining that kind of cool. Doesn't really snap on him, although he is being psychotic mm-hmm. in what he's literally doing. And that's when you get the reveal. And what I'm going to say is one of the best reveals
oh, absolutely.
Of all time. It comes with the gunshots, immediate pan over to Mr. Orange. And without even, you know, needing an explanation, you know right there it's been exposed. And so you have that story of Mr. Orange. You have the retelling of that stuff. And that's another very Tarantino scene,
yeah.
just in reconstructing that anecdote.
It's kind of a way that the film can take Mr. Orange and without painstakingly displaying how he managed to infiltrate this group, it takes one single action and just shows that action take place partially throughout each step until mm-hmm. he's in the group and you understand, you know, each step of the way, you understand why, how he got from point A to point
right.
B.
Yeah, you move through these different phases. I mean, the movie knows at what point to defy the screenwriting technique of it's always better to show than to tell. In some points, it says, we're going to tell you instead of show you to, you know, the stuff like the heist.
Right.
But in this instance, it says, here's something where we have someone just delivering an anecdote. We have an excuse to just tell you. That's what we should do. But again, we're going to defy convention and we're going to show you that instead. We're going to show you someone preparing an anecdote. It's right. just something really bizarre. You go through those phases. You go through... you know, learning the anecdote, rehearsing it, telling it, showing it, and then even the point where you're telling another anecdote within Tim Roth's character's anecdote. And he's just so slick about it. I mean, that's what makes that really effective, is the whole point of him learning this anecdote is to show that he will be passable, mm-hmm. that he will be believable.
Right.
And you show him learning it, he doesn't have the details, all the way up through the point where he's kind of getting better at it, until he's completely immersed in it, so much so that the camera fucking believes him. It's right there in the story with him. You know what else I like about the ear scene and the reveal there is it's kind of a double reveal, because you have the fact that, all right, Mr. Orange is the rat, but what you didn't know and what you probably didn't even suspect is that the cop does know that he has been tortured, and instead of being tortured in vain, instead of there being no purpose and he just didn't have any information, he really did hold in that information the whole time he was being mutilated.
Well, essentially that's because his option is to give the information, in which case he will be killed and mm-hmm. so will Mr. Orange, or to withhold the information and at least save one life.
Yeah, but often you see people either cave in a film or you see that they were tortured for no reason.
Yeah.
It's actually pretty rare that you see that they were tortured to the point of pretty much death and that they did withhold the information, that it turns out they did know. And so that gives you some hope for this cop. You know, you really want him to survive because he has some inside information, because he knows, and because, you know what, the guy managed to hold out. He managed to do a good mm-hmm. fucking job while he was being tortured. He should get to live, but he doesn't. Relentless movie, doesn't get to live. See, this is what happens when you start talking about Tarantino. You just stumble through the chronology so fast because there's so much to talk about.
Well, and there's always so little chronology.
Yeah, yeah, that's true.
There's very little that
happens. The timeline is pretty short.
But everything that happens is so dense in
yes.
mostly character and kind of nuance with mm-hmm. how the characters are behaving. A really interesting kind of character play throughout the film is Mr. White and Mr. Orange, where Mr. White is constantly defending Mr.
Yeah,
Orange. He feels
right.
responsible for him getting
father
shot.
Father figure for him.
And
know?
It ends up, you know, ends up getting both of them killed.
Right. There's another shot you see a lot in Tarantino's work, specifically Pulp Fiction. The first shot where Mr. White is bringing Mr. Orange back in.
Uh-huh.
And he's talking to Mr. Pink and you're trying to figure out who the rat is. And they kind of go back into what looks like a bathroom, you know, to wash up, and just they're both frantic. And you get that scene where the camera lingers in the hallway. In Pulp Fiction, that'll come up again
yeah.
as kind of hesitating at the door, you know, in anticipation. In Reservoir Dogs, maybe just a little more showy too, but I think it's also almost a fear of going in there. Those two characters are on fire. They are, you know, that's just the beginning of the conflict between Mr. White and Mr. Pink
right.
that, you know, that heightens very quickly.
Sure.
You get the iconic image of them pointing the guns at each other. Steve's character on his back pointing the gun up at him, them both yelling at each other. But that's the point where it starts. And you're waiting in the hallway, looking in at these two characters, wondering if a bomb is going to explode in
right.
that room. You know, another one of these scenes that it would just be a great tragedy if we didn't talk about in this, the first movie, is the trunk shot.
The trunk shot.
All right, so you've got these things memorized,
yeah.
right?
So in every Tarantino film, and even a Rodriguez film that Tarantino was a part of.
yeah, right, and From Dusk Till Dawn.
There's this scene, and it starts in Reservoir Dogs. The first time you see it is when Mr. Blonde opens the trunk of his car, and the cop is in there.
Mm-hmm.
But the first thing you see is the trunk open and the camera pointing up at the
yeah.
three actors
yep.
from the trunk of the car. This has tentatively been titled The Trunk Shot, although
yeah.
in the past two films of Tarantino's, the trunk aspect has been betrayed.
Oh, yeah, that's true.
Following Reservoir Dogs, there's the scene in Pulp Fiction.
The one where Vince Vega, you know, Travolta's character and Samuel Jackson's character, they both go in for the guns.
Right.
Vince Vega, by the way, so weird Tarantino trivia here. Here's a guy who has five or six irons in the fire
mm-hmm.
all the time. And one of the movies he talked about for quite a long time during the gap before Inglourious Basterds came out was doing a Vega Brothers movie,
mm-hmm.
which is Mr. Blonde from this movie, which is Vic Vega, as they mention in, it's actually in another one of the scenes that uses that lingering hallway shot where Vic and Eddie are kind of fighting. Him and then Travolta's character, Vince Vega from Pulp Fiction. Right. But okay, so you get one in Kill Bill.
Right, and then there was one in From Dusk Till Dawn.
Yeah.
Where...
pointing up at Quentin Tarantino, which is kind of funny.
The Gecko Brothers open the trunk, and where you find out that they've got that woman in the trunk of their car. Yeah. It's very similar to Reservoir Dogs. So then there's the one in Jackie Brown where they're looking in the back of Samuel L. Jackson's other car. Apparently, he's got many cars with many trunks.
Sure.
And then Kill Bill is probably that's my favorite. That is the most iconic for me, I think.
That's the end of part one, right? Mm-hmm. Yeah, with the motorcycle helmet, the ridiculous motorcycle
helmet. Where there's just someone in the trunk. There's always somebody in the trunk.
Yep.
But then we have the first betrayal with Death Proof.
Yeah.
Where they're actually looking under the hood of
I think that's really cool.
Vehicle.
I like that.
It's great.
Yeah.
And then in Glorious Bastards, I think it's one of the most...
It's the final shot I wanted.
It's the final scene.
Yeah, it's the final where, one. I wouldn't spoil it because some people actually, believe it or not, haven't
seen
Inglourious
Bastards. It's the
scene
where he says, this might be my masterpiece.
Right, sure. You didn't even name the character. Very swift. Very smooth of you. The only other thing that we have to say about Reservoir Dogs is that I think that Mr. White fires twice at the end, right? I
mean, he does. The gun goes off twice.
He shoots Eddie. Mm-hmm. There's this whole big thing about who shoots nice guy Eddie. It's kind of a mistake as...
There was a mistake in the execution, no pun intended.
Oh, you're doing one of those things I accidentally do all the time. Yeah, one of the squibs didn't go off in time or something. It went off too early, mm-hmm. and Harvey Keitel fell and
like
didn't shoot in the right direction.
He went off when the squib went off.
Yeah,
like
yeah,
a pro.
Right. But yeah, he fires twice and shoots Eddie, and that's how it's supposed to happen, and whether or not that happens in the movie is fine. And Mr. Pink does get away.
He gets away in the end.
That's just what happens. Which takes us into Desperado, in which Mr. Pink walks right on into the frame. I said I would spoil it, but I guess if you've never seen Reservoir Dogs, you don't even know what the fuck I'm talking about. I just thought that was funny when the movie starts.
Yeah,
and
it was
right
hilarious.
There.
It was perfect. So not only does he walk right into the frame, but he walks into, I guess we could just call it the first scene of Desperado if we wanted to be simple. But another thing we could call it is one of the greatest cinematic pieces in history.
Thank you. Thank you. I was going to correct you and say that what you mean is the greatest scene of all time. Steve Buscemi doesn't even know it, but he's about to trip into one of the best scenes ever. I think this is... Yeah, I use hyperbole all the time on the show.
Always.
Every other movie
constantly
is... Yes,
using
hyperbole. Everyone. Thank you. You're really fucking clever today. But almost every movie we watch is the greatest movie of all time. Half of the scenes in every film are the greatest scene in the film. But I really do mean this. No bullshit when I say this. I think this is one of the best openings, if not my favorite opening, at the very least, from any film I have ever seen. I could sit down and watch this anytime, day or night, any day of my life. It is awesome. This is the second in the Mexico trilogy at this point. A trilogy that's kind of sort of a trilogy.
Mm-hmm.
There is El Mariachi first, which people... I'm going to say that stupid thing people say, and this is the only time I really believe this. I don't know that you have to see El Mariachi. In fact, I'm almost certain that the continuity is a little rough between the two.
Right.
El Mariachi is an independent film Rodriguez made first, and if you care about independent filmmaking, an awesome film to see.
Absolutely.
An awesome film to read Rebel Without a Crew about. It covers a lot of this stuff from the making of Mariachi. It's a book that Rodriguez wrote. And something to listen to the commentary and the film schools on. But we're not really going to touch on that. I just want to talk specifically about Desperado. The thing we need to mention is that the Mariachi in the first film, a film intended for the Spanish home video market,
mm-hmm.
starred Carlos Gomez,
right.
who you see as one
right
of
hand.
The, yes, as the mariachi's right hand in this, not literally his right hand.
Although his right hand is damaged and he may need help.
I think that's his left hand to
it's
be.
Not.
It's
his right hand. That's his left hand.
Yeah, good job.
Shit.
Good job, guitarist. You're fired. I like that once you made guitar fingers, you could figure that out. You had to go like this in order to do it. Anyways. But now we have a big budget. Mariachi was a huge success at the festival circuit. It picked up all these different awards. Studios fought over it. A bidding war ensued over it. Rodriguez basically got his pick of which studio.
Right.
And then Desperado was made. So the point of Desperado was sort of to do Mariachi on a bigger scale. But in casting it, you couldn't use Carlos Gomez, who I'm pretty sure doesn't even know English.
Right.
You get a bigger action star. You get Antonio Banderas. In fact, everything is bigger. So to get back to this first scene, you want to introduce him as the mariachi. And you do that with Steve Buscemi retelling this story as a legend, going into the bar, and two things make this scene work. Steve Buscemi tells a great fucking story, and Antonio Banderas acts out a great fucking story.
He's the biggest fucking Mexican you've ever seen.
And both of those things fight for what, if I had to pick one of those.
Which side was better?
Yeah, I don't know, because every time we go back to Steve, I'd say, you know, I want to see the guns fire, but then he starts telling it and he's so good at it. And the reactions he gets are so good. His eyes, mm-hmm. I mean, everything about it, it's perfect. But then we go back to Antonio Banderas and I miss Steve. But of course, it's just fucking awesome. It's just paced so what? Here's what I like about this scene. You have the face in the shadow, you know, coming mm-hmm. in. The great way to introduce this character as legend, as a huge fucking Mexican. Once you get the actions going, I mean, guys are, they're literally flying. They're on giant wire rigs leaping into the air. It's so theatrical. It's so legendary. You get the sound of the spurs. It sounds like the mariachi is walking with a load of change in his pocket. But the thing that makes this work for me, and I think this might be the disconnect where some people don't get Rodriguez stuff and some do. I have a theory that it's musicians that get the Rodriguez stuff. Because I think, tell me what you think about this. We've never really talked about this. I think the rhythm of his action is almost to a beat. You can almost nod your head to how things happen. You know, and on each beat, he is picking up a new gun. He has this, it's almost like a short Tommy gun.
Right.
And then he's got the Desert Eagle and the sawed-off shotgun. And it's just pick up a gun, it flies in the air, it nails in his hand, he shoots a guy, gun flies out, another gun flies up, picks it up, shoots a guy, flies out of his hand, and it's just one after another after another. And the scenes are just this uniform, beautiful length, just one after another. I feel like it has rhythm as if it were a song.
I can see that. I mean, Robert Rodriguez has always, well, not in this movie. Robert Rodriguez eventually started doing all the music.
Yeah, that's true too.
If you watch a lot of behind the scenes stuff, it's rare that you see him without a guitar in his hand.
Yeah, right.
He's kind of scoring the film while he's shooting through the camera. Yeah.
So no time to waste.
That would make absolute perfect sense for the films to be shot in a musical way.
Musicians make great editors. We've seen that before on the show when the people who do the music will also edit the film, and the scenes have good rhythm to them. It's not even that there's a musical component to that scene. It's not that he's, you know, doing it along with a song.
Right.
There's just great rhythm to how the action works. And with that rhythm comes a sort of relentlessness. You know that there's going to be another beat right after the third one. There's going to be a fourth one, and he's going to nail another guy, and it's just going to hit in perfect symmetry. It's like when you see a band live and every single member is just on that machine tempo. They are just right in sync. And I think the next scene is almost as good. You know, you have the opening with the storytelling scene, but then you do have one with music.
Right.
It's this sort of surreal dream sequence, which you don't know at first.
It's the intro credit scene.
Right, right.
It's where he turns around and he's a mariachi. He kind of looks a little goofy.
Yeah.
And then Desperado is written across his chest.
Right.
Essentially.
The title of the film,
and
right
fucking
there.
You realize that the film is not just the first scene,
mm-hmm.
but it's the first scene and this scene packed together. It's beautiful, horrendous massacres mixed with a musician. It's a musician massacring people.
He's a mariachi after all.
Well, in this opening scene, so we first see Carlos Gomez. Yeah. He turns around and they're playing a song in the middle of this nightclub bar. It's a very happening scene. Everybody knows all the words. Everybody's having a great time.
Yeah.
And a bar fight breaks out.
Mm-hmm.
Looks like it's fucking Cato Kalin or something.
Yeah.
And the mariachi kind of takes a stance on the bar as if he's ready to charge like a fucking bull.
Yeah.
But instead, he cocks his head to get the other guys in on the action. And then the three of them,
they walk along the bar.
In kind of a vanguard formation, just move toward this guy. And there's a 1-2 hit and he is out.
Yes. Yeah,
the song
the
still
guy.
Plays.
Yeah, right. Right on the beat of the song, right? This womanizing douchebag at the bar just smacks him with the neck of the guitar. And the thing I love is that the guy's head whips around and a stream of blood just squirt, total gratuitous, just as if the guy had sneezed this giant stream of blood out of his mouth and goes right back into the action, just goes right back into the song. And then the song ends with that surreal moment where nobody claps and everyone stares. And you're thinking to yourself, well, he just
everybody
hit that guy over there. It's a good song. What's happening? And that's where you get
that's where you get all of El Mariachi.
Well, yeah, you get Moco coming back, which is cool. Moco, I will never get a chance to hit on this, but the actor who plays him in the first film and reprises the role briefly in the second film is somebody that Robert Rodriguez met while essentially being a lab rat. He subjected himself to medical testing in order to pay for his films. In fact, when he was shopping mariachi around to different studios, he still had the scars from all of the medical testing. But yeah, that was one of the guys he met there, and he told him, oh, you'd be perfect in my film. But I guess we should talk about budget stuff while we're on that really quick. You know, financing his first film is fantastic, and he only had to raise $7,000 for it, which especially by today's standards seems like nothing to make a film.
Right.
But when you see mariachi, you understand why it probably only cost $7,000. Although back then, everybody's shooting on film, nobody's shooting on digital. Rodriguez wouldn't even shoot on digital till after Desperado. But when he had the budget for Desperado, and this is the only reason I know money numbers, is because I know Rodriguez money numbers. He shot Desperado for $7 million. Now, we've talked briefly about how many million dollars films cost on this show, especially around the time we were doing Repo and a couple of those films. You know, if you're shooting an action movie like this, it's not uncommon to get $70 million, literally 10 times what he's shooting with. And because this guy is an absolute master, the best of the best at doing films on the cheap and still getting great films, getting great action films out of this budget, he was able to keep the budget low. And that's how he gets a lot of these projects done. Projects that would never exist because he couldn't get the studio to finance them. Things we'll definitely cover later, like Sin City or even Grindhouse. A studio would not go for that if it required the kind of budget that a film like that by all rights should require. So here's how he does that. And I'm going to explain how he creates all of these iconic images at the same time that I explain how he has this low budget. It's such an ingenious technique. He used to call it the mariachi style of filmmaking because that's kind of where all that originated. I think of it as the trailer method. Robert Rodriguez sometimes creates, but often just in his head, creates a trailer for what he would like this movie to look like. We're seeing this now with Machete, something that he created a trailer for in Grindhouse, and then said, you know what, I got a lot of film. Maybe I should just make a whole movie out of this. So when you see a trailer, it's often the best parts of the film.
Right.
So Rodriguez will create these iconic moments. What's cool? A guy with a machete in his hand, and then there's some women without their tops on, and a giant explosion. You know, these great moments. And then he will craft a film around that. That's often why his films don't have an incredibly strong narrative that makes a whole, you know, you see that in Desperado. It's a straightforward action film. But a straightforward action film that gets you from one awesome scene to another, to another, to another, until the film is finally over and you're left completely exhausted.
Right. And you're just wondering, were those really Salma Hayek's tits?
That is what you wonder at the end, don't you? This also allows him to create a very minimalistic pre-production stage. He knows exactly what he's going to shoot, and he doesn't shoot anything more than he needs. That might not be as true these days when digital, you can shoot for an hour or 100 hours and it costs pretty much the same thing. It costs whatever it costs to charge your batteries. But in the days of film, a ton of the cost came from, I guess it's not only, you know, the cost of the film reels themselves, but you have to keep actors around longer than you wanted. You have to pay crew for more hours.
Right.
He got away doing mariachi without even feeding his crew. That's, you know, one of the ways he got the production down so much, the costs. So when he's doing Desperado, to make sure that he doesn't need to get in there and waste time, instead of doing storyboards, which you normally do for a film where you take some blank paper and you cartoon out what you want things to look like, he would get ideas for storyboards and then he would shoot video storyboards. So, you know, Antonio Banderas at the time, apparently his time was very cheap and he would hang out with Robert Rodriguez. They'd go to this bar and they would kind of act out that they'd practice essentially. And he would get a good idea for how he wanted to frame the shots, where he would move. And that way they're not wasting a second.
Right.
They get in there when they have the full crew and the lights and the cameras. They get in there, they shoot everything, and they get out of there cheap, fast, efficient, and easy. They also use, especially in the early days, what's available. They know, okay, we can use this bar. We have this small town in Mexico where we know the, you know, the people who work at the local news station. We have access to these guns, these vehicles, these trucks, and you try and when he's writing his films, which is something he can do because he writes his own films. he can write in the items that he knows he has to make the budget look like he had money to go buy a giant truck, sure, or you know, especially in Mariachi. That's a movie that's almost composed just of things Robert Rodriguez found that he could put together in a film. And then the final thing, and this is my favorite thing, is that you do everything yourself. In any given film, what does Robert Rodriguez do?
He directs photography.
Of course.
Music.
Mm-hmm.
Directs. Writes. Produces.
Operates the camera.
Operates the
camera. Important part.
Casting.
Did you hit editing? Because I think that's a key
also
one,
editing.
Too.
That's the big one.
Yeah. Because editing, when you're your own editor, you know exactly how much coverage you're going to need. You know where you need to go. What kind of light you need inside your frame. A lot of these things, you know, when you don't edit your own movie... say you controlled everything but editing, you would still have to shoot a lot more than you need because you don't know at what point they're going to make transitions. Maybe this scene's not as bright as this scene over here, so you can't cut them back to back because it would look awkward. So you control a lot of those things in your head, and you also make a movie, and this is the most artistically pleasing part, you make a movie that is exactly what you wanted.
Mm-hmm.
No other hands get involved to fuck things up.
Exactly.
At no point can, you know, if you make a shitty movie, then it is your fault. You can't go out there and say, so many of these movies we see that have flaws, the creators come out and say, well, then it went to these people, and they're the ones who fucked it up. And there's no way to do that when you are 100% behind the film. So no conversation about Robert Rodriguez would be complete without at least a mention of the film school. We've talked about a lot of the stuff that's actually in the Desperado film school on the show. But if you haven't seen any of these, so what Robert Rodriguez does is for all of his movies, when the DVD comes out or, you know, fuck, this is 2010. So just look it up on YouTube, right? You can find this stuff on the internet. 10-minute film school, just Google Robert Rodriguez 10-minute film school or whatever, or maybe the titles of the movies. But on each DVD, he has a film school that he does. It's just a short presentation where he shows you something cool about filmmaking that came out of the movie. So he just shows you these little techniques here or there. I mentioned a long time ago on the show that I did a DVD for a band called The Birthday Massacre. And the only way that DVD was accomplished is using techniques from the El Mariachi film school, stuff I learned there. So you can check that stuff out. He also does 10-minute cooking schools. Sin City Breakfast Tacos is my favorite one, but those are worth looking at too. A couple other roles we didn't really get to in this movie. Quentin Tarantino coming in as the pickup guy in an era where Tarantino really, really wanted to act. So Rodriguez wrote this part for him, and it's a great part. It's so Tarantino. It's perfect, and it fits into the storytelling and legend stuff that we mentioned earlier. Danny fucking Trejo is a giant Mexican. Awesome. Salma Hayek, this was really what brought her into the United States. A lot of people, and you know, to some extent, Antonio Banderas as well, but people didn't even know what a Salma Hayek was until Desperado. And she showed up again in Once Upon a Time in Mexico, which was the so-called sequel to this film. Kind of in the Sergio Leone way, where the movies are, you know, the Man with No Name movies are kind of, they all star the same guy. It's sort of a different, it's an adventure in the same universe. It reuses some of the actors that died off previously in the other movies. Once Upon a Time in Mexico kind of does that as well in paying homage to the Leone stuff. You know, the unfortunate thing, I would just love to keep doing Tarantino and Rodriguez movies all the time. The unfortunate thing is that, one, our audience would kill us. And two, there's just so many more Rodriguez movies than Tarantino movies.
Yeah, there are far too many. So we should definitely state right now that when we say we're Rodriguez fans, we don't mean, man, we love Desperado, and man, we love Planet Terror, and goddamn, do we love Sin City. We also love Spy Kids, Sharkboy and Lava Girl, and Shorts, which we did last year.
Yep.
I fucking love every single one of those stupid little fucking kids movies.
Yep. Hey, do you have The Faculty on DVD?
I own The Faculty on goddamn motherfucking DVD.
I've even seen that made-for-TV thing you did, Road Racers, which I will have to show you at some point. Impossible to get a hold of that thing. Another one. I mean, it's a little bit different than the usual stuff, but Robert Rodriguez just produced the new Predators movie. It's based on a treatment, really I think it's a rough draft that he did 10 or 15 years ago. I mean, a long, long time ago. And he didn't direct it. He wasn't one of the final writers on it. Really, I think he just did some of the, he was a supervisor for some of the special effects. But still, you and I both saw that and had a fucking blast. It was a great film. So definitely something people should go and check out. I'd love to talk about, you know, why he only took on that producer role, why he took on so many fewer roles. That would be a stark contrast, not just to Desperado, but a lot of the stuff he's done. But unfortunately, I think it kind of falls outside of the scope of this show. Just something people should know is also awesome. Anyways, big fans of his stuff. Love and adore everything he does. And you know that when he has a movie coming out in cinemas, it is going to be a great fucking time. That is midnight material for sure. And so there you have a Tarantino film and a Rodriguez film. Once again on double feature, as always on double feature, back to fucking back. We also have some midnight material, but a different kind of midnight material coming up next on the show. Before we get to that, what does double feature have that other people need?
We have a website, doublefeatureshow.com. We
go
have
to that thing.
An email address, doublefeatureshow@gmail.com.
We need that.
We are on Facebook. We have iTunes.
Do we? I don't know if you could say we have iTunes. It sounds like something a grandma says. Like, how many iTunes
do you have?
We have
iTunes.
Yeah, we have a thing on iTunes.
We're on
right?
iTunes.
All right, there we go. Go on there and leave us a comment. And if you don't like Rodriguez films, the best place to tell us that is in a review on iTunes.
Yeah.
Because otherwise, I will just delete your email and we'll never know about it.
Great. Fantastic.
One other thing that we failed to mention on the year-end episode that we just did. Two things. One, I was really in the hospital during 20 Weeks Later in Cloverfield. That wasn't just a shtick that I was kind of doing there. Somebody sent us a message, or I think it was a review or something, going, oh yeah, I thought Eric was just doing that because, you know, Cloverfield and Handycam, and it was on his phone or something. No, really went to the hospital, but totally doing great now. The thing I actually wanted to mention, though, we got a donation from Gary. We got to do something different with donations. Great that people are still sending donations. Not so great. I don't have any more carnival jobs. I'm out. Gary, I don't know. We might have already given you one. That's the other thing, is I'm just not keeping track, which was a terrible idea. So we need new ideas. Doublefeatureshow@gmail.com. Send us ideas. What I kind of want to do is some kind of contest thing. Maybe if you donate, you get a recommendation for a film we should do, or we draw one, or I really have no idea. So one, continue to send donations. Donate.doublefeatureshow.com. And two, let us know. We'll just retroactively make whatever we choose to do as of right now. With Gary, what do you think we should do with the donations? Need a brand new idea for year three. All right, so what's coming up on this goddamn show?
Well, we haven't done enough Kubrick, so we're going to do The Shining, and then we're going to do Bright Falls.
You're really showing your hand here, aren't you? All right, but you've seen The Shining, right?
I have.
I'm going to come right out and say that, too. I am not a big Kubrick fan. I think that's one of those films, one of those directors that gets far too overanalyzed. But a lot of great stuff in The Shining.
Sure, The Shining's good. And as I said last year, Clockwork Orange, still absolutely adore the film.
For sure.
But now, Bright Falls.
Okay, so here's the thing with this Bright Falls thing. Bright Falls is very... This is the first and only time, hopefully I will... Maybe it'll come up on next show, but I hope not. But this is just to get people interested, because this is both an awful statement and a wonderful one. Bright Falls is very Twin Peaks. It's very David Lynch. It's got a tiny bit of the okay part of Stephen King. The writing about a writer sort of weird stuff happens. And it's essentially, 30 minutes long or something?
That's the best part, is if we're going to do The Shining, we need something that's 30 minutes long.
So I thought about doing it with a David Lynch film, but that's just not given. Bright Falls is really fucking cool. And we'll talk about it next time on the show. But I wanted to do it with something that kind of set the tone, but wasn't just, hey, look, David Lynch, and something that's like David Lynch, because I think it's a lot more than that. But it's really fucking screwy. And if you're into the David Lynch stuff, or The Shining maybe, or if you like anything we ever do on the show, you should probably check that out. You can get it for free. It's on brightfalls.blogspot.com, or you can just search for Bright Falls. It'll pop up. And it's done in episodes. It's kind of a little viral thing. So probably one of the shortest things we'll ever do on the show, and no point in not watching it.
Sounds confusing as hell.
It's going to be a little confusing.
Watch more fucking film.
Bye.